we go into this study. Help us to gain a deeper understanding. For it's in your Son's holy name I ask.
Amen. Well, I just want to let you know, next week, we're going to go ahead and take our vote on our next study. So that'll be coming up next week. So be much in prayer for which study you'd like to do. I'll have the ballots ready and hand them out next week for you. Also coming up next week, we're going to be in Luke chapter 15, which means some of you may have been waiting for this and looking forward to this. We're going to be talking about the parable of the prodigal son. This is probably the one of the most popular parables, or probably the most popular teaching of Jesus, perhaps next to John 3:16. So next week we'll be looking at the parable of the prodigal son. We'll look at another parable there in Luke 15. And believe it or not, we have just a few weeks left. We probably have about 4 to 6 weeks left, if even that much left of the parable. So we're coming to a conclusion in our study on this. Tonight we're going to look at chapter 14, and we're going to basically look at four different sections. This all starts with, as you're going to see here in a few moments, where Jesus was invited by a Pharisee to come eat dinner with him. And so upon his eating dinner with this Pharisee at his home, there's a man who comes, and Jesus heals this man on the Sabbath day. Well, this leads into some teachings of Jesus. And he's really going to talk tonight about discipleship, as you'll see. He's going to tell the parable of the wedding feast in verses 7 through 11, the parable of the great banquet in verses 12 through 24, and also the parable of the, well, wise or really unwise, in this case, builder, in verses 25 through 35. So that's what we'll be looking at tonight. How many of you, and I know many of the ladies went this past December, how many of you have ever gone to the Billy Graham Library down in Charlotte? A lot of you have. A few years ago, I had a chance to go down to see this library, and it's very intriguing because you see the Crusades on television, you hear about the impact this made, you see Dr. Graham speaking on television, but I learned while down there that there's a lot of planning, a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff that takes place to get these crusades going. For instance, it takes a lot of planning. It don't just pop into being, you know, it takes a lot of planning to get it ready. It takes a lot of faithful giving by several different individuals. It takes a lot of people, a lot of unseen people behind the scenes to get this thing done. I would dare say that there, well, I can obviously say there's far more people than we'll ever imagine who were working behind the scenes than those we saw there at the Crusades. A lot of unseen workers, a lot of strategic planning, and a ton of devoted prayer went into this. Now again, we see the crowds, we see the results, but we don't always see the work that goes into such a thing. So tonight, Jesus is going to tell us about counting the cost, as he has in some previous parables. He's going to talk about discipleship and what discipleship really means. Now, in this day and time, a lot of times, and let me just go ahead and clarify this from the outset, there's nothing wrong with emotions. Emotions are very important things. Emotions are things that drive us, but it can't all be about emotions. We have to have a matter of the will. We have to understand what it is we're deciding to do. Because in some nations, if they decide to follow Jesus, there's some severe repercussions that could come having followed him. And so we learn about discipleship, that it's not just a matter of we say a prayer and then it's all done from there. There's a lot more to it that we're going to find here. Discipleship comes from the word mathetes in Greek, which is defined as a person who's really a student, one who learns from another by instruction, whether formal or informal. In other words, a student. And we as Christians, we must never get to the point in time, any of us, regardless who we are or where we are, we never should get to the point and say, well, I already know everything. Because I guarantee you, there's going to be something else that the Lord is going to show us that we don't know. We can never get to that point. Before we can truly teach, we must first learn how to be a student. Before we can lead, we must first know how to follow behind the footsteps of Jesus, because that's what discipleship is truly all about. So someone, if you will, read for us the first section tonight. We're going to look at Luke chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. If someone will read Luke chapter 14, verses 1 through 6 for us.
And it came to pass, as he went into the house of one of the chief Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath day, that they watched him, and behold, there was a certain man before him which had the dropsy. And Jesus answering spake unto the lawyers and Pharisees, saying, Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? And they held their peace, and he took him and healed him, and let him go, and answered them, saying, Which of you shall have an ass or an ox fall into a pit, and will not straightway pull him out on the Sabbath day? And they could not answer him again to these things.
Okay, so here we go. Jesus, as we mentioned before, he's invited to this Pharisee's house. Not every Pharisee was antagonistic to Jesus, but it does seem like someone may have done something here, as we've talked before about some previous occasions, may have planted something to see what he would do in a particular situation. Now, this marks the third time that Jesus healed a person on the Sabbath day. The Sabbath day usually began on Friday afternoon at 6 p.m. and lasted to Saturday at 5:59. That's when the Sabbath day would go. Now, Christians celebrate on Sunday. Why do Christians celebrate on Sunday? The resurrection, absolutely, because the Lord resurrected from the dead, raised from the dead on a Sunday morning. So that's why we worship on Sundays. But the Sabbath day classically went from 6 p.m. on Friday to 6 p.m. on Saturday. So in other words, the first time Jesus healed a person on the Sabbath day was in Luke chapter 6, verses 6 through 11, healing some sick people in Nazareth. The second time was recorded in Luke 13, verses 10 through 17, where he healed a woman with a disabling spirit. I think it said something like she had this like something like 17 or 19 years, I believe it was. And then here we find the third time here in this passage of Scripture. Now again, a particular ruler of the Pharisees had invited Jesus to come dine with him. Now here we find a person who had dropsy, which is kind of like the palsy. He approached Jesus at the ruler's home. And again, we mentioned there's a possibility that this could have been a plant, so to speak. Now, to do that was reprehensible in ancient times. Craig Keener writes that eating bread together was supposed to be an occasion for intimate fellowship. Treachery or less than friendly motives among those sharing a meal would repulse ancient readers. I mean, this would be one of the most horrible things that you can imagine if you're living in ancient times and you see this taking place or you read about this taking place, absolutely repulsive, especially with it being on a prominent teacher on the Sabbath day. Now, dropsy is a condition which is basically where the joints would fill with fluid. And I'm kind of wondering, it's sometimes noted as being like a palsy or some sort. But I kind of wonder if it's not sometimes like maybe severe arthritis even, you know, where you know, you have a stiffening of the joint, so to speak. And so, but it was a little different. In this case, you had fluids building up around, I guess that's different. I may be wrong, maybe about the same thing. But we had fluids building around the joint, so to speak. Now, in ancient times, it was popularly considered that this was a curse for a sin, but obviously this is not true. The Greek text implies that Jesus knew their thoughts, so before anybody could say anything to them, he starts to teach and starts to go into these parables that we're going to hear in a few moments. But he first of all asks a question of them. If you have an animal on the Sabbath day that falls by the wayside, is in trouble, are you going to help it out? Now, in ancient times here again, if they didn't answer or if they couldn't respond, it was essentially known, well, they lost the debate there. I mean, if they couldn't respond, you know, it was definitely known that, you know, Jesus made the point here. In the last verse we read, verse 6, we see that Jesus' wisdom is seen as almost irrefutable. Jesus then strikes at the heart of their problem. They had become lovers of rituals more than lovers of God. So that's an important thing to remember. They had become lovers of rituals more than lovers of God. Now, we're going to start looking more at the teachings of Jesus here in this passage of Scripture. But before we do, it's important we take a look at this. Because, let me just ask you a question. When you were in high school, were there a lot of cliques of social status? You know, things like that. Like you had the jocks and you had the other, what do you call them? I hate saying this, just nerdy kids. I was probably more in that group. You have all these different groups of kids, you know, and they rank them the popular kids, the less than popular kids, and things like this. Well, in ancient times, when at the dinner table even, there was a seating order, okay? That, if you can see this real good, let me jump over here on this other side. The circle part of this represents where the person's head would be. So they didn't sit in a straight chair. They kind of reclined back. They had these couches that were arranged kind of almost in a, you know, three quarters of a square. Kind of a U shape, upside down U shape. Well, now here's the thing. As you enter the room, this is the way you'd be looking at it. And so the guest of honor, the one who was given the highest status, was seated about right here, because a lot of times people would come and listen to the discussion. They would listen to some teachings or something like this. And so if they were gathered around, it would be in this area that everybody could see and everybody could hear. So you had the middle couch. This was the place of prominence. Then you had the host, who would sit here, and then his family and friends would sit here. And then a lot of times in ancient times, they would have some other guests. Some people who really weren't part of the crew, but they'd invite some other people, and they would just throw them over here. And this was the high couch. Now, notice here's the table. So you have the low couch and the middle couch. They could reach the food pretty good. The people on the high couch, they'd have to kind of reach over and down to get to the food. So the lower status people were over here. The highest status people were right here, and the host and his family were right on the blue section. Now, let's jump into the next parable, and you'll see why it's important for us to understand this. Someone read for us, if you will, verses 7 through 11 of chapter 14.
So he told a parable to those who were invited, when he noted how they chose the best places, saying to them, "When you are invited by anyone to a wedding feast, do not sit down in the best place. At least one more honorable than you be invited by him. And he who invited you and him come and say to you, 'Give place to this man,' and then you begin with shame. Then you begin with shame to take the lowest place."
To 11.
"But when you are invited, go and sit down in the lowest place. So when he who invited you comes, he may say to you, 'Friend, go up higher.' Then you will have glory in the presence of those who sit at the table with you. For whoever exalts himself will be humble, and he who humbles himself will be exalted."
Okay, so let me first of all say, sometimes people would invite the poor and those who weren't quite of their status, put it like that, maybe just a little bit lower than their status, if and only if those people could do something for them. And we're going to learn a little bit more about this in the next parable. It may be that for instance, like say if you had a business dinner or something like that, and the host, he invites some more of the poor, and the host is trying to have a guest of honor who owns this other business, and he says, "Now you see, I invited so-and-so over there. I'm a good person. You can trust me. You can do business with me." So the poor actually in that case helps boost the host's reputation. Or maybe the those who were invited on the other side, they could maybe put on a song and dance or something like that. Or they could do something in return. And that's going to come more of an issue in the next parable that we see. But now let's go back to this. Now, again, imagine if you go into a home and you're invited to a dinner and you sit here, but you actually were supposed to be here. This was the lowest place of honor. What if you accidentally sat here, but you were actually supposed to be here? What do you imagine would happen? You go in there, and everybody's reclining here. Now, can you imagine? You have to stand up, crawl over off top of everybody, go over to this other position that was supposed to be your position, and you sat in the guest of honor's position when you were really supposed to have the humble low end of the table. Would you say that would be embarrassing? Absolutely. I mean, this is something that people would probably find horrific in ancient times. You know, to sit in a place of honor only to find that you're supposed to move down. Jesus is basically making a point here. He's basically saying that the disciple, his disciple, must be marked by humility. It would be a humiliating thing to put ourselves on this high status, on high on the totem pole, only to find ourselves knocked down several steps. Jesus is basically telling us that a clear-cut principle, and here he's talking especially to the guests, that God will dishonor the proud, but will elevate the humble. Those who are proud in themselves will fall and will ultimately be humiliated, but as the proverb says, pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10:12, very valuable advice here. Let anyone who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. So we have to understand that we're girded up, we're held up by the Spirit of God, and we can't get to the point in time where we think more of ourselves than we should. Our boasting should be done in the Lord and not in ourselves. So I think that's the point that Jesus is trying to make in that particular passage of Scripture. Let's take a look at verses 12 through 24 as he moves into another parable here, the parable of the great banquet. And so we're in verses 12 through 24.
Then said he also to him that bade him, when thou makest a dinner or a supper, call not thy friends, nor thy brethren, neither thy kinsmen, nor thy rich neighbors, lest they also bid thee again, and a recompense be made thee. But when thou makest a feast, call the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind, and thou shalt be blessed, for they cannot recompense thee. For thou shalt be recompensed at the resurrection of the just. And when one of them that sat at the table and heard these things, he said unto him, blessed is he that shall be fed in the kingdom of God. Then said he unto him, certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and showed his lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said unto his servant, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor, and the maimed, and the halt, and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and hedges, and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you, that none of those men which were bidden shall taste of my supper.
Can't help but read that passage of Scripture and think of that old hymn, in the highways and hedges I'll be working for the Lord. I can't remember exactly how it goes, but I remember that part, and every time I read that, that's what I think of. Here again, people in antiquity sometimes would, those who were trying to make a name for themselves, they would invite the poor to make themselves look good, so to speak. They would invite the poor to give themselves to show everybody, hey, look how good I am, you know. But now there are some groups that had nothing to do with the poor. For instance, if you were a Levite, the poor, crippled, lame, and blind were forbidden to take part in sacrifices. Now, how many of you ever heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls that they found? That was found of a group of people called the Essenes. They were extremely strict. I mean, they were basically, they were a community of monks, but they were extremely strict. They would not even let the poor, crippled, lame, and blind participate in their community meals during that time. Well, Jesus here, he's basically telling them, not only should you invite those individuals, but you should do it not expecting anything in return. Invite everybody to this wedding feast, okay, or to this feast. And then Jesus brings up another parable and then talking about the end time. Now, Jesus, there's an anonymous person, we don't know who it is, he proclaims something like, "Blessed is everyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God." Now, this is talking about the end time wedding feast we learned about in the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 19. And then this talks about, this leads Jesus to bring the parable of the great banquet. So what he's talking about is the invitation to everyone to take part in God's kingdom. The invitation going out to everyone to be part of this great celebration at the end of the time. And so this parable goes and talks about a man, and this man represents God, who's holding this great banquet. And basically he goes out and he invites some of the higher status people of his time to come and banquet with them. Now, in ancient times, well, just like what we're doing Saturday, of course, you know, we had RSVP for their dinner coming up Saturday. We had RSVP. Well, that's what you did in ancient times. If someone was throwing a big banquet like that, you had to RSVP saying, "I want to be there. I'm planning on being there." And so he did this. But we find that there were a lot of people who were offering excuses. For instance, the first person, one individual claimed that he needed to see about a field that he just purchased. Well, let's think about this. That doesn't really make sense. Because how many of you ever have bought a car without looking at it? Someone tells you, "Hey, there's a good deal down the street. You got to buy the car." And you just take out your wallet. "Well, here, go buy it. I want it." You don't know anything about the car. You go buy it. Well, the same thing was true back in ancient times. You want to see the field before you purchased it. So this was basically a poor excuse. The second individual claimed that he needed to examine 5 yoke of oxen. Well, if you were wealthy enough to be able to afford 5 yoke of oxen, you could get one of your hired helpers to go check out the 5 yoke of oxen. So here again is another excuse. The third individual claimed that he had just gotten married and could not come. Now, wait a minute. That sounds like a good excuse, doesn't it? You would think. You know, "I just got married. I can't come." Well, that would be a good excuse if the host was asking him to go off to war or something like that. But this was a banquet. And this was a banquet set way off in the future, wanting to know if he would come to this banquet. So, and there's nothing saying that he couldn't bring his bride with him to the banquet. So, again, you see that's a bad excuse. Anyhow, the host became angry and told his servants to compel people to come. They want to go out in the highways and hedges and invite everyone to come to this great banquet that the host is holding. Now, here again, understand that what he's saying. The host represents God. The servants represent us, inviting everybody to come to take part of this great banquet. And those who receive and accept are those believers who come into the kingdom. This invitation is given. It's given to everyone. And so whosoever will come, let him come. But you need to understand here, this word used for persuasion or compel or tell, however your translation words it, is the Greek term anakazo, which means, it doesn't mean that you force someone. Now, have you ever heard of the Bible beaters or Bible thumpers? Someone take a Bible and bump them on pop them on the head and say, "You got to come." That's not what they're saying. That's not what they're saying at all. Neither is it just saying, "Well, come to Jesus one time and you don't say anything else." What this is saying is a persistent, not an annoying, but a persistent persuasion trying to get someone to come to this wedding feast. Howard Marshall notes that he is to urge more people to come in. The use of the word implies the situation of oriental courtesy in which an invited guest will at first politely refuse to come until he is pressed to do so. So in other words, keep asking. Don't just ask one time and give up. Keep asking. I mean, don't annoy or anything like that, but you know, there's a fine balance between annoyance and just giving up too easy. But tell people about the kingdom of God. Give the invitation. Let people know that everyone's invited to God's great wedding feast. Persistent, compassionate, persuasive evangelism is what he's talking about, but never forceful. So that's something we need to remember as we work for the Lord. And going backwards, finally, someone read for us, if you will, verses 25 through 35, Luke chapter 14, verses 25 through 35.
Whether he has enough to finish it, lest after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, "The man began to build and was not able to finish. For what king going to war against another king does not sit down first to consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? If it is neither fit for the land nor for the dunghill, but men throw it out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear."
Okay, verses 25 through 27, we see Jesus has now left the house. He's now left his home. He's walking down the street, and there's a mass of people following after him. You know, there's a lot of people following after him. And Jesus does something unusual. He realizes that there are some people who were following him who are really committed to follow him, but he also realizes that there are some people following him who's just wanting to see what the next miracle will be. They're curious. There's others where he fed 5,000 men, which is actually more like 20,000 by the time you count women and children. Some people may be there because they want another free meal. You know, they're following along, seeing where is he going to go, what is he going to do, what's going to happen. Well, Jesus says, listen, if you really want to follow me, you got to do it on God's terms. You know, you got to seek, genuine disciples must enter through discipleship. We must become disciples of Christ. Now, first of all, he shows us three things that we need to do. Now, first and foremost, Jesus says something very controversial. He says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father, mother, wife, children, brothers, sisters, yes, even his own life, he can't be my disciples. Wow, that's a very strong statement. Now, what in the world does he mean by that? Because now remember, he also said the second great commandment was to love your neighbor as yourself. Well, your mother, father, sister, brother, so on and so forth, they're considered your neighbors. So what's going on here? Here's where it's important to understand the ancient languages and the way they work. Jesus is using a comparative term. In other words, he's not literally meaning to hate, but he's talking about the love of God that you have for God should be so strong that compared to the love of anything else would be considered much less. So in other words, the love that we have for God must hold the highest realm. And that's why he says the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. So he doesn't literally mean to hate someone. And this also applies to, if you go back in the Old Testament, in the book of Romans, where it says, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. Well, it doesn't literally mean hate in that regard. It means Jacob entered into a covenant relationship with God. He was close to God, so that relationship with God was much stronger than any relationship that Esau had. So it's just the way that Greek and Hebrew works, and it carries over into the English. So again, he's not literally saying that we should hate someone, but he's talking about the devotion we have for God should take a prominent role in our life. Now secondly, he also talks about carrying up one's cross. So, in other words, first of all, he's saying that the love we have for God, we must love God more than any other personal relationship. Secondly, we must love God more than the self. Because the cross was an instrument of death. You know, it was upon the cross that Jesus died. So what he's saying in this regard is, you can't come and be a disciple if you love the self more than you love God. You've got to even give that up. You know, you've got to come to God giving him your whole heart, your whole life, making him the Lord of your life. And then thirdly, he gives a brief parable about these unwise builders. The parable correlates with Jesus' previous statement. Now here he's talking about the love of material possessions. He talks about, for instance, about this unwise builder, about someone who starts on a building project, but it doesn't quite work out. They don't finish it. Now, there was a, I can't remember even where this was, but we saw a house. It was going to be a beautiful house. They got the frame of it up. They had one side of it with the vinyl siding on it and everything like that. But there was another wall or two that was just completely bare. And it just stayed like that. I don't know if they run out of money. I don't know what happened, but it just sat there. And so they had three quarters of the building project done, but they just stopped, and all that money went to waste because they didn't prepare is the only thing I can figure. But you see the same thing here. Back in 27 AD, there's a story about this amphitheater that was so poorly built that it collapsed and killed 5,000 people. It was halfway built, and so it didn't hold up. So here you see Jesus is saying that before you build something, obviously you want to count the cost that's going to take to put it together. In like manner, he gives another example of a king who poorly plans a war. Now, who's going to go against in a war against someone that you don't know how many they have? You don't know what type of force they have. You don't know how anything like that. Obviously, that's something you want to know before you enter into that. And so Jesus, through this, is saying, he's saying that the love of stuff must take a secondary role, must take a back seat compared to our love for God. And by the way, there was an interesting thing that happened with King Herod Antipas, where he tried to go up against Rome, and obviously it didn't work at all. So there's kind of a parallel there. So what he's basically saying here is he's calling upon what many people have said to be lordship salvation. In other words, that if Jesus is not Lord of all, he is not Lord at all. Because for him to be Lord means that he has control, that he's in the pilot seat. You've seen those stickers that says, God is my co-pilot. Well, what this would mean is instead of him being your co-pilot, he's the pilot. He's in the pilot seat, and we're sitting following after his direction. Because he also shows us in verses 34 and 35 about salt. Salt was used as a preservative as well as a flavoring agent. But if salt was not properly produced, it would lose both the ability to be a preservative and it would lose its flavor. So what was it good for? Nothing. it's just fit for the trash heap, you see. So what he's saying is that we as Christians, we must be disciples. We must ever be following in his footsteps, letting him take the lead, letting him, in fact, be the pilot of our lives. So let's take a look at a few applications and we'll enter into our time of discussion. Number one, I think through this study we find following God is more important than even following traditions. We must make sure that we let God lead us more than any tradition that we make. Secondly, personal humility is a mark of discipleship. When we start feeling good about ourselves, which, you know, I'm not saying we shouldn't because we're children of God, God saved us. I'm not saying that we should always be pouring ashes on our heads and saying, woe is me, woe is me. That's not the point. What we always need to have is a healthy dose of understanding that God is the one, he's the reason why we have a relationship with him. He's the reason why we have life. And he's the reason why we can have love in our lives. So we must be humble. Personal humility is a mark of discipleship. Trust God to meet your needs now and later. I think that's another thing we find a mark of discipleship. Discipleship requires a complete surrender of one's life and possessions over to God. Now, it's not always easy. Now, if you're like me, I'm guilty of this. I'll say, God, I'm going to give this to you. Then I pick it back up. God, I give it back to you. Let me pick it back up. And I think there's always a struggle. I don't think any of us have this down pat completely. I think this is an ongoing process that God is working in our lives. But the fact that we're on this process, the fact that we're on this walk, is a mark of discipleship. We're never going to have it together on this side of eternity, but we keep striving for the mark that Christ has put in front of us. Following Christ must require an intellectual dedication as well as an emotional devotion. It's not the mind or emotions, it's really both. We make that mental decision to follow Jesus, and we are filled with the Spirit of God following emotionally as well. All right, let's open this up for a time of discussion. Number one, what habits, rules, or traditions do we sometimes place in, do we put in the place of ministering to human needs in Jesus' name? This doesn't have to be church related, it can be anything. What things do we often do that hinder us from ministering to other people? Any takers on that one?
We classify people and we put the dividing walls in between us and them.
Amen.
So that we have an excuse for, you know, not participating, not approaching.
Amen.
We set them aside to the point that, you know, as the Pharisees did, you didn't hang out with the poor, you didn't invite the poor. And we do that with certain groups and people that we label them, and then that causes us to keep our distance.
Amen. Well said. Very well said. And I think that's something, that's a good point, Philip. I think that's something we need to try to break too. A lot of times we have the us versus them mentality, you know, this group versus that group, or so on and so forth. You know, we're put here to minister to all people regardless of what they look like. And like you say, the labels we put on people, that's very good, very good.
Oftentimes we're worried about our needs and issues and concerns, and we either don't feel adequate enough to help somebody else, or we feel like we have to have our stuff taken care of before we can help somebody else.
That's right.
But that's not how God told us to do it.
Amen. Amen.
And he'll take care of us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the picking it back up. It's very hard to let go of my God because we feel the need to fix ourselves.
Absolutely. Any others? Well, going right off of what Faith said, what excuses do we offer not to do kingdom work? I mean, and you kind of alluded to that. What excuses do we offer sometimes not to do the work that the Lord has set before us?
Our problems are bigger than theirs.
Yeah. Any others?
A friend that might be misconstrued.
Right. Absolutely. That's a good point. Yep. He said that, I didn't.
I'm just like, I've told the kids the last several weeks, you know, things that come on in Sunday school. God doesn't call the equipped, he equips the called.
That's right.
So you can't look at what you have and what you don't have. And you know, God called Moses, his speech impediment, to go before the king. God will use anybody anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way he works. So you can't look at, you want me to do what? Because he'll give you what you need to accomplish whatever task he is.
Amen. It was kind of like at Bethel last night, I was telling Monday night. What is it? It's Wednesday. Okay, never mind. A few nights ago. I'm all messed up. Was talking about my testimony, you know, and you always, you know, whenever I was in high school, I felt inadequate when he called me to the ministry. And I told everyone, you know, if you talked to me 2004, 2005, I'd say, there's no way I'd be back in ministry. But look at how God works. And that's true of any of us. He has a task for all of us to do, each and every one of us to do. And he'll equip us for the task. Anyone else? All right, last question for tonight. What is the cost of following Jesus? What does it mean to follow Jesus? What is the cost to follow Jesus?
Might be granted a Christian.
That's right. And you know, in
some places that's not a good thing.
I thought a lot about your friend over in Mosul, and what is it like? That it's like an N symbol, I think they have in Arabic, that they label for the Nazarene is what, you know, they label that for on Christian places. And like you say, not everywhere that's a good label to have. That's right.
I guess that would be one of the ultimate costs. Or, I mean, the ultimate cost would be to be your life, I guess. Like Jesus did. But,
absolutely.
Bad being somebody can.
Absolutely.
You know, I've heard the saying that the payment plan on earth is nothing but the retirements out of this world.
Yeah.
But in essence, the payment plan is everything, because he asks for everything.
Right.
So to the cost of following Jesus is everything, but the payback's more than we can imagine.
Amen. And that's a very important thing to remember. I mean, and that really goes into the effect of what Jesus is saying. Those who want to save their life will lose it. In other words, if you want to hold on to your life and you want to be in complete control of your life, then in the end, it's going to be ultimate loss. But if you lose your life, you give your life over to the Lord, then you basically save your life, because eventually it leads into eternity in heaven. So that's kind of that lordship salvation, you know, letting him take the reins. And it's not an easy thing. It is not an easy thing at all. I think we'll all attest to that. Anyone else? All right. Well, next week we'll take our vote. We're looking at five possible studies. We're going to look at either doing a study on the miracles of Jesus, looking at the miracles of Jesus in a chronological fashion, looking at the life of Joseph, which is an excellent study as well. It's a true rags-to-riches story. Okay, and so the life of Abraham, which is another great great story. We'll look at his life, or the study of the Proverbs, which I've never really done a study through Proverbs. I've always loved Proverbs. There's some good stuff in Proverbs. And then also the life of Paul, the great evangelist. So consider those, pray about those, and we will see where the Lord leads, taking our vote next week. Now, also coming up next week, we'll take a look at the parable of the lost coin and also the parable of the prodigal son. That's coming up next week in Luke chapter 15. Any other thoughts before we close? If not, we'll ask Mickey if he would to close us with a word of prayer.
Heavenly Father, we praise you and we're grateful for the opportunity to worship and study your word tonight. Keep those who aren't able to attend in our thoughts and prayers, and go with us as we feel renewed and excited to spread your word.